Hi, welcome to a new lecture. Here you learn how to use Beautiful Soup, a very important web scraping library for Python. Now, we use Selenium throughout this section. And why are we using Beautiful Soup? And what's the difference between Selenium and Beautiful Soup? Well, Selenium is more targeted for browser automations, which means you can use Selenium to automate actions on a browser, such as filling text boxes, clicking on a button, logging in and out, and so on. So you can use browser automation to scrape values then, or log in and do actions. But if you want to just extract data from a website, you don't have to open the browser like you do with Selenium. So for that purpose, we can use Beautiful Soup, which is a more straightforward approach to web scraping. So you can think of Selenium as a hybrid between browser automation and web scraping. So it does both. And think of Beautiful Soup as a library exclusively for web scraping. So for this lecture, we're going to scrape currency rates, the real-time currency rate between any two currencies. For that, we're going to use xrates.com, x-rates.com. And so that's a web page. You can go to currency calculator and then you will see the current currency rate between these two current currencies, which is US dollars and Indian rupee. So the first thing you do is you want to specify manually on the browser what currency rate you want. So currently this is US to Indian rupees. If you want to change this to, for example, euros to Indian rupees, the page will refresh and you'll get the rate for euros to Indian rupees. Now, the browser address bar also changed to another URL. So now it's, as you can see, from euro to INR, which is the currency code for Indian rupees. So anytime you change this, let's say from euro to USD, the browser will point to another URL. So any currency rate has its own URL and we can make use of this to access the value for any URL. So for any conversion between any currencies. All we have to do is just have this as a string in Python, this URL, and then change, for example, EUR to USD and the two part to INR or other exchange currencies, and so we get the value for any currency and then we extract that value from the web page. So let's do that. I'm going to create a new empty REPL. You can do this on your local IDE. Scrape currency with Beautiful Soup. So Beautiful Soup is the name of the library. Let's go ahead and import it from BS4 import. Now BS4 is how you use Beautiful Soup, but the way you install it is you go to the terminal or to the shell on REPL and you say pip or pip 3.9 or 3.10, whatever you're using, install Beautiful Soup 4. Beauty I here. Execute. Once you have installed it, then you import it as from BS4 import the Beautiful Soup class. And then the way I'll approach this is I will write a function, define get currency, and this function is going to get an input currency and an output currency. So two arguments. So these will be the currency codes. So USD, EUR, INR, etc. And then inside this function, I'm going to construct a URL, which is going to be an F string. So basically I'm going to copy this URL and paste it in there. And then instead of your, I will have a placeholder. So let me expand this like that. So inside there will go the input currency entered by the user. So from that currency to, instead of USD, I'm gonna have alt currency. So two variables. So let's test that. I'm gonna print the URL and just call the function here, get currency, enter for example INR here and USD, and then execute the Python file to see if the URL is being constructed correctly. So that's the URL we get. If I click that, we're gonna get the rate here, so the page from Indian rupees to USD. So from Indian rupees to USD, and that was the rate. Right, now that we have the URL correctly constructed, then we can go ahead and get the content, the source code of this web page. The source code is on a web browser. You can find the source code by right clicking over the page and then go to show page source. And I need to expand this. So that's the source code that constructs this web page. It's a combination of HTML and CSS and JavaScript. So you want to access all that code from Python, and we can do that using requests. So you need to import requests and also install it with pip install requests. So with requests, we're gonna get access to the page. So the content of the page, the source code, is equal to requests.get, you enter the URL there, .text. And if you print out content and run the script, we have this name error. I've got a typo here, URL instead of UR. So that local variable. And that's the source code. That is the same source code that we saw here on the browser. Now, out of that source code, we only want this number. So that is hidden somewhere in the source code. If I search for that using this button here, 0.0133, you see it's somewhere in here. We want to get that number only from that entire source code. So that number shows up when I search, but if you want to go directly to that number, you can right click here and go to inspect element. Again, that will point to that part. You may need to expand this by clicking that triangle button. And so that's the number again. It's hidden in between this span element, HTML element. So I'll keep this window open here and go back to my code. Now, the idea is that we need to parse that source code. And this is where Beautiful Soup comes in. So Beautiful Soup is designed to understand HTML structure like this. It knows, it has knowledge about elements and how an HTML page is constructed. You know that it has this div tags, and these div tags may have other elements inside, and so on. So the next step is then to have a variable. Usually it's called soup. You can write, you can call it whatever you like, but that is equal to Beautiful Soup, that class. So we're making a soup here basically by using the content that we got via the request library here. The content goes there, and you specify that we're talking about an HTML.parser. That is the parser that Beautiful Soup is going to use, because there are other languages such as XML if the page is built on that language, but usually it's HTML parsing what we're doing. So HTML parser goes in there, and now if you print out soup just to see what it is, run, so this time the function will print soup. It's basically the same thing, but this is a more specific object. It's a beautiful soup object. So now internally it has knowledge about what each of these elements are. So then you can do soup.find and you specify what do you want to find. So what we want to find is a span element. That's the span element, so it has inside this text. And now there are various span elements in the source code. So we want to be more specific and say that we want the span element with a class of this value. So I'm copying this with Control C and going in here, and then you say class with underscore equal to that class value. So if we print out this output, which I'm going to put it in a variable currency, and then I print out currency, and we see what we get. So you see that with that we got the entire element, including the class of the element and the value that we want. Note that this value is changing every certain time, so you may not see the same value as you saw in here a minute ago. So it's changing, it's real time. And so out of this now, we want to extract, using the getText method, we want to extract only the text. Only that part. So run, and we get this. And that is the current rate. Now, this is a string, as you may notice, it has this USD part. So it's good that we get this as a float without the USD part. But before we do the stripping of that string, let's first make sure that this function is working by trying some other values here for the currencies, euros to something else. Let's see what we have. AUD for Australian dollars, AUD, run. Yeah, that's the current rate for that exchange. It seems to be working. Now let's clean out that string and get only the float, the number. What we actually want is we want to remove the last four characters of the string. So one character, two, three, and the space between the number and the currency code. Four characters. To do that, what I will do is say currency, or I will rename this variable actually to rate. It makes more sense. That is the rate. That's the rate. So the rate is going to be at the current rate. So we want from 0 to. So we're splitting the string. From 0 means we want the character with index 0. That is the character with index 0. And then we want the dot also, and all the numbers, but we don't want the characters from minus 4. So minus 4 means the space here. So we have minus 1 for D, minus 2 for U, minus 3 for A, and minus 4 is the index of the space. So from that to that we don't want. And we don't need the 0. This will do it. So that one. If I run this, this time we're going to get the number only, but this is type string. If you print out the type of that value, you're going to see it's an str. So what we want to do also is convert it into a float, and then you run it, and then it's a float. Now we can do math operations with that number, so it makes sense to return the correct data type because it's a number, it's not a string actually. And so finally, this function should return the rate, that. And so if I run this, nothing is going to be printed out because we don't have a print function anymore here. So if you want to print out something now, you don't put print functions in the function, in your custom functions. That's not a good practice. We did that because we were developing the function and we were looking at the intermediate results we were getting, but now we want to return that. And then if you want to print, you say print here. So print the value of that function, and you get that value. Alternatively, you can say current rate, a variable, and that is equal to that. So current rate is now a variable that has the actual float, the actual rate of the currency. You can print out current rate, and you get the same output. So that's the final code. Now, later in the course, we will build a desktop application with a graphical user interface where the user can choose from a drop-down list, can choose the currency rate, the source currency rate, and the target currency rate also in another drop-down list. And then they can enter a value and then click a button and then get the converted rate in the targeted currency in the user interface. So it's a real desktop program. We will build this in the GUI section where we built GUI applications further down in the course. So that's something exciting that I wanted you to know, and I'll talk to you later. Thank you.